Everybody's, we have a micro video from our last session up there. It's been a while since you've been here, but we did micro videos last time. And we're just wondering if anybody has anything they'd like to share in the chat. They could add a few things or feel free to take the mic.
We were thinking micro videos, but also if there's anything from previous sessions or new things that you've tried that you'd like to share with the group, that would be we're totally open to that as well.
So it's 2:00. Want to get started, Gretchen and team?
Let's do it.
Let's do it. All right. Well, welcome everybody. Monday meetup coming at you after the holiday. We had a little hiatus there, and but we're back, badder than ever. And I hope everybody's staying cool today. Well, you can't seem to be.
Nope.
Kept happy. Either we're complaining that it's too windy, too cold, or just too yucky, and now it's too hot. Oh, well. So I am Denise. I am an instructional coach with the program department, and I'm joined today with Gretchen.
And I'm the Elementary Indigenous Education Special Project Teacher with the Elementary Program Department. And then we have Teen.
Hi, everyone. I'm Tina. I'm one of the instructional coaches with the LKDSB. Excited to be here with everybody. I threw something in the chat that I think is probably pertinent to everybody at this time of year is how is everyone doing in terms of student participation, or kind of trends that we're seeing? And it looks like that it is mixed, that interest is and engagement is a tough thing at this time of year. And I think it will be particularly tough for this week with the warm weather and as we move into June. So thank you for your honesty. It's great to be able to kind of share the challenges together and then like look at them together and maybe look at some potential strategies and things that we can try together to make sure that we are trying to keep our kids engaged as long as possible.
Perfect. And we also have Stephanie down in the bottom, Stephanie McCollum. She's going to be joining us later on today. A few minutes to talk a little bit about some exciting things that she has going on in her classroom. So look forward to hearing what Stephanie and her kids are doing. There's a little brief outline of what we're planning on talking to today about. We have a land acknowledgement. Teen's going to talk to us about play, kind of bringing back some math games and how that's a useful tool in the classroom, online as well. We're going to talk a little bit about some provocation videos. And then if there's time, we have a little open Q&A session. So this is a beautiful photo we have want to share with you today. It's Raveningtown on the Thames, and it's found on the southern shores of the Thames River, small town near Thamesville. It has a population of approximately 550 residents. Delaware Nation at Raveningtown is one of the oldest settlements in this region, and it was founded in 1792. The community played an integral part in the War of 1812. This picture shows a 1.8 kilometer walking path that also provides an opportunity for people to better understand some of the species of plants and animals native to the land. The name itself translates to mean a good path in the Lenape language, which is the language that's native to the Delaware people. And the trail was recognized for its efforts in 2015 as the winner of the Canada Conservation Award winner. And Gretchen just has a few notes that she'd like to share. Yep. Talking about the Lenape language.
Yeah. So part of this, like this part here is part of our land acknowledgement, and part of our traditional territorial acknowledgement or land acknowledgement is a commitment to do more and to learn more. So we had a difficult time with the pronunciation of that name of the trail. And just about 5 minutes before, our session here, I got a text from a friend in Raveningtown, or the in the language Lenape Lakuit,
And so she gave me the pronunciation. And so it's weletahang, weletahang. And so we did have a difficult time. And so the Delaware language or Lenape language is a language that is spoken by very few people. And in the community of Lenape Lakuit, there's only one fluent speaker left. And it is said that she is the last fluent speaker of this language. There are some very strong language revitalization efforts happening in the community, but we as teachers should do our part to offer support. We as teachers should commit to learning the incredibly important history of the Lenape people. We should invite people from Lenape Lakuit or the Delaware Nation into our classrooms to share the language and to share their stories and the amazing history of the people. And we should also commit to ensuring that we are teaching the accurate history of the relationships between Canada and Indigenous people who call this land their traditional territory for hundreds of years before colonization. And so keeping that part of that commitment part of land acknowledgements is important, and it's something that we should always revisit. Are we making the commitment? Are we following that commitment? So today we are joining you from the LKDSB, which is part of the traditional territory of the Chippewa, Potawatomi, Odawa, and Delaware nations. These nations agreed through their ancestral languages to the mutual sharing of the land with obligations and responsibilities to the environment. Today, these responsibilities and obligations extend to all peoples.
Awesome. I love that last part of the land acknowledgement, always the piece that is it, you know, that those responsibilities extend to all people and that we mm-hmm. accept those responsibilities. I see there's a few people who are joining us today that are maybe new to the sessions. So thank you and welcome. Thank you for taking time out on a really lovely day to join us this afternoon. Just a little bit about our sessions as we move through our sessions today. We try to keep it as free flowing as possible. So if there are any questions, if you want to jump in, please feel free to participate anytime. We're totally okay with stopping and addressing questions and we want to be as responsive to your needs and what is on your mind as much as we can.
Awesome. So Stephanie, I've unshared my screen so that it's all up to you now. So please welcome Stephanie McCollum. She's going to share with us some of the great things that she's doing in her classroom with breakout rooms using Google Meets.
Hi, I'm Stephanie. Oh, sorry. Okay. I'm Stephanie. I'm the grade 7-8 teacher at East Lambton. I was on here at one of the first meetings and I said that I was trying to do group talent or group work and I was trying to use Google Groups and it wasn't working for me. And so I was trying to figure out how I could engage my students and get them to work in groups, but not written, because the written portion wasn't working for us. So we had done the breakout groups in one of our first sessions in this meeting, and I really liked that, but I was like, I don't know how to do that with Google Meets. And then Melissa Dent sent out an email, and it had a link to another teacher somewhere else, and I don't think it said who it was, and I apologize if I missed that name, but anyway, she had suggested a way to do it, so I played around with it to figure it out. So what I did was I asked my kids who was coming online. I sent a remind message home and I asked for the parents to have the kids let me know if they were coming or not. Most of them let me know, which was great. So I made a Google Doc. And can you see my Google Doc now?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. So I made a Google Doc and I put them into groups and I went into Google Meet and I started my meets and then I saved the link. And I put the link into my Google. So you're joining me right now. So when I saved, okay, sorry, it's starting. So I put my Google Meet link into my calendar. And then from my calendar, I was able to save it. And then I put the kids into groups and I gave them each their own link. And so they would be able to go into that link when I asked them to. We have a really supportive staff at our school. Mrs. Wilson, our principal, she likes to come on and join in with the kids and interact with the kids. And Mrs. Thompson, our resource teacher, also comes on and off. I reached out to another one of my colleagues, our kindergarten school teacher, and I asked her to come on. Teen came on for me, and one of our EAs came on. Coincidentally, we had one adult for every group. I just didn't want to lose anybody in their first time doing it. I have a student, a very weak student, who was coming on for his first time, and I was so nervous I was going to lose him, and I didn't lose him, and he was happy, and he was able to make his way back. So we started out in our main link. So in my Google Classroom, I have a link within my Google Classroom. So the kids know that's always where we go. And so I just said to them when we met in this link in the first place, I said, okay, we're going to go into these groups. If you can't figure out where to go, if you get lost, come back to that Meet link and wait for me there. I'll come back and forth. I gave them a 10-minute time frame. We were doing a short activity, and I'll explain that in a second. And then I said, after the 10 minutes is over, we'll come back to that Meet link. So they always knew that that Meet link was our home base. And if they were lost, if they needed to find me, they knew where to go. So what I asked them to do was to just draw a quick picture on a piece of paper and with a piece of paper and pencil before we left our big group. So they drew the quick picture, and then they went to their name. And I'm going to explain that in a second. And they got to their link, and then they were able to go into their groups, and they described their picture to the people in their groups who tried to draw it from their description. So it was just a communication activity. The main point of what I did, though, sorry, I guess I shouldn't have closed that Meet. One second. Oh, got too many things going on in my cursor or in my bar. Sorry, give me one second. Oh, there we go. Okay, so when I wanted to share it with them, I went into my Meet. Sorry, guys, I'm holding up. I closed this and then I have to reopen it. So I went into my Meet and I went to my doc and I took my shareable link. The problem the first time was I just took my link at the top and I didn't get the shareable link. So they weren't able to get in the first time. So I took the shareable link, I copied it. And then when I was in my doc, I was able to post it. Or in my Meet, sorry. Thought I had everything open that I needed and then I didn't. I went into my Meet, into my chat. And I was able to post the link in my chat. So the kids were able to go to that link in the chat. They were able to open the doc. And then they were able to click on their group link of where to go. I did tell them to leave our main group when we were done and go into the second group. And then they could go back to the classroom to re-enter it, because it kind of is funny. You can hear yourself talk in different groups if you don't close it. So they did their activity and they came back. And the extra teachers really helped just to make sure we didn't lose anybody. And I'm going to come back to my screen. Okay, and the kids said that they enjoyed the time to talk, and it wasn't me leading them. It was the fact that they could talk to each other about what they were doing and not necessarily listen to my guided activity, and they liked that time. So yeah, it was a success. We'll definitely do it again. And I'm thankful that Melissa didn't send that email out so I could take some time to figure that out. Okay.
Thanks for sharing, Steph. I had the opportunity to be a part of the activity as well. And I really loved how much thought and preparation went into it. When you generated all those links in advance then, Steph?
Yes. And I saved them in my calendar. And then I think I did them the night before. And then I just pasted them into the Google Doc so they were ready to go for the next day.
Okay. Are you able to reuse those links? Can you use those same links for like multiple sessions then, if you want to do another, say like another session next week, would those links still be active?
Well, while you're talking, I'll just go on my phone and check that and find out.
I really like how you're able to include some more teachers in with it too. I really like that you could invite, I like that you invited the principal to come in, but you could invite like your coverage teachers to come in as well too. I think that's really, really awesome to keep everybody included in that.
Absolutely. Yeah. And our staff is really good. Our prep teacher, our French teachers, our prep teacher, our secretary, our resource teacher kind of float in and out of our Meets. And so it's nice to have the other people there, not only for the kids to see them, but to kind of guide them along the way as well. I am able, those links are still active, so I can go back into that link.
Perfect. So you would have to only just make them once. You wouldn't have to keep creating those then.
Yeah, absolutely. I just saw that Jennifer Latta just asked about the activity. Mm-hmm. What I did was I had the kids draw for two or three minutes, a quick drawing on a piece of paper and a pencil. I explained to them they didn't need to be an artist because I didn't want kids not to come because of that. And I just said, just draw a quick picture on a piece of paper, and then, but don't tell anybody what it is. So they went into their small groups, and I only had two or three kids per group. And then one at a time, they described their picture to the other people, and the other people attempted to draw their picture on their piece of paper to see how close they got their picture. So it was about the kids describing, using the descriptive words to what they had done, and working on listening skills for the other kids in the group to see if they could put it together. And some of them were quite happy. Mr. Nago quickly learned that it's hard to draw on your technology and show your technology on the screen. But they had fun with it, and it wasn't super curriculum based, but it engaged them, and they enjoyed it. And it was just a short activity for us to figure out how it all worked and then to try to put it all together.
Mm-hmm. And I think that, like, although you say, like, Steph, that it's not curriculum based, I think that, you know, like, part of our curriculum will be, you know, relationship building within our online communities and our online classrooms. And also, like, it's not a big stretch to be able to extend what you've done to curriculum, right? Is that we could get into, you know, draw a scalene triangle, or, you know, and get into some of those kind of concepts really easily. And then you've already kind of built kind of a framework for how you want kids to do that. So I thought that was really, clever.
And I guess the only thing else I didn't say, sorry, I keep talking, is that I also was able to bounce in from group to group. So I was able to go in and check in on them. We only did it for about 10 minutes because our Thursday chats are just a small kind of a challenge activity. So they know that they're only coming on for 10 or 15 minutes on Thursdays. And so I just quickly kind of jumped into each activity, checked in with them, made sure everybody was working at it, like everybody was handling it okay. And then I'd go from room to room. One of my students was having trouble accessing it, but she wanted to do it. So she FaceTimed the other girl on her phone while that girl was in the activity, so that she could still take part even though her computer wasn't working with the Google Meet.
That's awesome. Problem solving.
Yeah.
Sam in the chat there says that she likes the safety net you created for your students. So you mentioned you had the one student that was a little apprehensive about joining online, and this was actually his first.
It was.
Yeah. And everything went well with him?
Yeah, I had called him. Sorry, one second.
So Karen, mommy just has to finish for one second.
I'm really sorry. Just give me just one second. Just...
That's fine.
Okay. I'm really sorry.
You're multitasking. Doing everything there.
This is the reality of our lives.
Yeah. So, it was my student's first time. He is a weaker student, and he doesn't come on without his mom home just for accessing and motivation, that kind of stuff. And so, her and I had practiced the night before with him to get him on, and then I called him on his home number to get him on to remind him 10 minutes, and then we're going to log on. So he logged on, and he enjoyed the activity. And the teacher that was in the rooms with him said that he was very happy the whole time and smiling. And I'm really sorry.
Learning adventures.
And he was able to come back on. Taryn, just one second, mommy. One second. I'm really sorry. He was able to come back onto the into the group class, and he was able to make it through just fine.
Awesome. And you know what? You did a lot of work ahead of time to prepare the links and everything, and also just to touch base with your students. That's fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you. We enjoyed it. Thank you. And thank you for giving me a chance to talk about it.
Thanks, Steph.
No problem.
Steph was, I'll share that she was a little bit reluctant to join and share at the start. So we want to make sure that we open the floor up to everybody, is that what you're doing in the classrooms is really amazing and inspirational work. And you might not see it that way. Please, like, you know, reach out to us and say, like, you know, I don't know if this might be helpful to somebody else, but do you mind if we share? Everybody in that joins us is welcome to share and lead the learning. And we would really appreciate if you did that, actually. It's great learning for the group and for us to kind of learn and think through things together.
Teen's going to play a few games with us right now.
Okay. So I showed this always intimidating Venn diagram here a couple weeks ago, and I want to kind of cycle back to it because I think there's a lot here that will help us not just today, but in kind of going forward. Our inkling right now is that remote learning will be something that will be kind of part of our lives for the next little while. And part of that will be thinking about these three spheres that we as teachers kind of think about in order to make that educational experience for students. So that idea that like within our classrooms, our online classrooms, like we have to treat them like a real classroom, and that a part of that reality is that there's a social aspect of learning, that what we do, the learning that we do together is social by nature. And then also like there's the thinking that happens within learning with this cognitive presence, and then also how the teacher shapes all of this and where those things overlap. So kind of in the overlap between the social presence and the teaching presence is this idea of like setting climate, and Steph's activity right there with like, you know, building that social component with the teacher intervention and setting that climate, that safe space for learning to happen is really critical. And then also we're thinking about how do we like get kids engaged in learning, and in the classroom, what we often do is we include that idea of play. And that's something that we've kind of been thinking about is how do we take these really critical parts of what we do in our face-to-face classrooms and adapt them so that we can still use them in an online setting. So these are some examples. This is just one example of the ways that we can do that. And as with everything, like it depends on teacher intent and what and how you want to use it. So this is a game that many of you guys have probably seen before. It's the game is called How Close to 100. So the first part in our roll is two number dice. The number that comes up are the numbers that you will make an array on the hundreds grid. So it's a game for practicing their multiplication facts. So something that we know that most students can probably do a little bit of extra practice and support with. So in this is the slide. I'm gonna everything that we do will be shared in our show notes. So those of you that are new to joining today, resources that we share, any links will be in the show notes, and we'll post those in the end as well. So here's the actual game board. So they've done some really creative things about how to use the tools within Google Sheets. So for example, if one way of playing this might be teacher to class, another way might be what Steph's done is you might give them a link to this and they could play it in their breakout room. So if you had breakout room set up for two players, then you could also send them off to play the game together. So this was something new that I'd never seen before is on the slide here, is actually a YouTube video, and what it does is it creates random dice rolling. So as I click that, it plays, and then you pause it, and then it gives you a variety of different dice rolls. So player one rolls, so then I'm gonna do 3 times 6. And then, so what they can do is they can use the tools in Google Slides to actually draw that array. And then what they do is they shade that, they fill that with their color to show that array. And then they can track the recording on the next slide. Okay. Is there a question coming up in the chat there?
Brandon just says that he gave this to his class to use with their families at home. And then mm-hmm. he also has the website up there, but it's toytheater.com for the dice.
Perfect. So this is something that I shared, something that you might not be aware of that you can do in Google Slides that might help streamline some stuff for people, is that you can, when you cut and paste slides from different presentations.
0, 0, 1, 0, 0.
Is that this slide is actually part of another presentation. Is that it remains, I can actually, when I drag and drop it into this presentation, that it remains linked. So any changes in the original file will actually be reflected here. So say, for example, that you had an activity, like a kind of a key assessment or an activity that you wanted to get from students, you could actually drag and you can copy all of those, all of that slide into one slide here and be able to see everybody's responses in one spot. For some people, that might be a valuable tool. So just there's lots of different ways that we can incorporate games. I know some people have been using Cahoots in the classroom. Brandon shared with me a really cool game on Twitter. I'll put that into our show notes as well. That was kind of like a Tetris type game that we could share with students as well.
Brandon added that you could use Jamboard for this game as well.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of people who are loving like kind of Jamboard slides. There's kind of a lot of people using both mm-hmm. tools, and I think it really depends on which one. It's personal preference for a lot of it. Mm-hmm. As we're kind of thinking about how we design our online learning for students, this was something that I referenced from that Caitlin Tucker article a couple episodes ago, and it's that 5 E's model. And thinking about, so you know, through that cycle of learning, are we designing around these kind of key ideas? So, you know, if we're engaging into a strand, like how do we engage? How do we challenge their prior knowledge? How do we provoke? And this was something that we felt fit really nicely into our topic of the idea of provocation and provocation videos. So part of our series that we've been working on with you, which we started last week, was, or 2 weeks ago, with our micro videos. A provocation video is kind of what we're going to look at today. So I'm going to pass the baton over to Denise here.
Thank you. Great work, team, segueing into what we're going to be talking about here. And we talked about micro videos last week, or 2 weeks ago. And we are going to talk about provocation videos today. And we're talking about engaging students in their learning. And provocation videos are another tool that students can use. Teachers can challenge their thinking. The main thing about provocation videos is it's kind of like some intentionality to your learning. You have an idea where you want your students to end up or where you want them to go, and you're kind of guiding them to promote their thinking on a certain topic or concept. This is an excellent way to kind of segue into a topic. The main difference between provocation videos and micro video is that these ones are just about sparking some kind of curiosity or posing some kind of question for your students to get their ideas thinking on a certain topic. So they're open-ended. They kind of motivate students to do a little bit more digging. Your audience probably is your class if you're going to end up making one on your own. Some concepts that we have thought work well with provocation videos are using mysteries, science, the inquiry process can lead well into there. The tools that you would use are kind of the same as what you would use for a micro video. You might want to use iMovie. You might want to use screen sharing. There's all kinds of apps out there that help you with Keynote, there's Clips, there's Notes, Seesaw, great way for all the primary folks. They can embed their videos right in Seesaw. So kind of like micro videos, these are short. They're usually less than 90 seconds in length. When you compare the quality to a micro video to provocation video, they're a little bit more polished. Sometimes there might be some music that you've added. There might be some text that's animated. There could be some kind of background noises that you've added to kind of further get that feeling across to the students. We have some examples, as always, of ways that we are going to show you some of our provocation videos. The first one we're going to show is Gretchen.
Bonjour. Hello. My name is Gretchen, and these are some artifacts that have been given to me by my dad. My family and I are from Wapple Island First Nation, also known as Pakejunong Territory. This is where these artifacts came from.
Did you have anything you wanted to add to that?
Yeah, so that video, you could just send that out to your kids. You could send some links with some information maybe about Pakejunong and the people from Pakejunong. You could share some links about arrowheads or about some of the stones that were used for those artifacts. Yeah, and I think that this is a good way to spark inquiry and to ensure that you are including Indigenous stories and Indigenous voices in your language arts or in your science as well.
Awesome. So that is a video that Gretchen made. It would be a video that was teacher created.
Yeah, and I just use clips. I just use Apple clips for that one as well, and it took me about 10 minutes. I made it last night. So yeah, just Apple Clips is easy and quick to use. So, yeah.
Perfect. Thanks, Gretchen. The next two examples we're gonna show are student generated provocation examples. And this one was an assignment that a student had to do to generate interest in books. They had to choose a book that they thought that one of their classmates would like to read or to promote interest in that book. And so this was made on iMovies. It was made using the trailer option that's on iMovies. And this is a student example.
Thank you.
And the great thing about the iMovie trailer option is it there's literally templates that the students can pick, and everything is laid out for them. It shows them how to put in the production company at the beginning if they want. It shows them how to add some credits at the end as if they were the producers of the actual, well, I guess they are the producers. And then it tells them, insert a headshot here, insert an action video here, insert different things here. And then they choose the music that they think accompanies, you know, whether they want some kind of a climactic song that they got going on here. Very nice options. Text can be animated, as you can see, sometimes she had words that appeared. Okay. This next one is another student one. I used to read the book Skeleton Creek to my students, and I was online one day last year looking around at some stuff, and I came across a book that was by Patrick Carman. He is an author, and it's called 315, and then I think it's called Things That Go Bump in the Night. And the premise of the book is it's three things that you do with a story. So you listen, then you read, and then you watch. And so the first one, it gives you a code, you go online and you listen to an audio introduction to a narrative. Then you go back to the book and you read a couple pages of the story. And then it gives you another code, and you go online and you can watch a video that is the ending to the story. So my kids ate this stuff up. And so I had the idea of using this as our narrative writing unit for when I was teaching last year. And so students had to come up with their own 315. They had to have a audio component, a written component, and a video component. And it really took the whole planning to a next level with narrative. Most kids don't like to do planning. Anyways, with this, you had to plan. You basically had to start with the video portion first, decide where can I do a video, how can I make this look good, and then you work backwards. So this is a sample I want to share with you of a student's introductory, it's just audio version basically of her story. So you'll hear a little intro, and that was how all the 315 videos started.
My name is Jesslyn Siwa. I'm a reporter not far from New York. I was writing a story, a very interesting story, but just before I was about to publish it, someone sent me an email. It looked like a security tape or an interview, but it was just the audio. I have no idea what it is, but this might change everything.
So from there, then we would go to read the written portion of her story, which is the middle part of her story. And then there was an ending part of her story. And needless to say, her video definitely sparked some interest. There were a lot of students that couldn't wait to finish reading this young lady's story. I like this one because she really took it to the next level. There was sounds. I'm not sure if you could hear them all in the background. Some kind of eerie, creepy sounds that I added to the mystery and the suspense of her story. Another one that we're going to share now is a quick one. And this one teen is about a sketch to sketch strategy.
Yeah. So this is something that I wanted to try to always keep my kids engaged when we're doing our read aloud. One of the strategies is sketch to stretch. So we want students to visualize and kind of have that mental picture of what's happening in the story, because that kind of shows comprehension. So I would have students sketch out the scene from their mind, and then we would kind of look at those together and then think about, you know, what are your clues, what's your evidence, why does this work. So this is an example of how we could maybe use an audio only clip. So this is the beginning of The Outsiders, where Ponyboy describes himself.
When I stepped out into the bright sunlight from the darkness of the movie house, I had only two things on my mind: Paul Newman and a ride home. I was wishing I looked like Paul Newman. He looks tough and I don't. But I guess my own looks aren't so bad. I have light brown, almost red hair and greenish-gray eyes. I wish they were more gray because I hate most guys that have green eyes, but I have to be content with what I have. My hair is longer than a lot of boys wear theirs, squared off in the back and long in the front and sides, but I'm a greaser, and most of my neighborhood rarely bothers to get a haircut. Besides, I look better with long hair.
So I made that. If you're on an Apple platform, that's something that you could, with those dual tracks, with that backing track, you could do that in GarageBand. I did it on my Windows computer with a free piece of software called Audacity as well. So that's where I could just drag a song in, and then I can record my audio on top of it, and it gives me different tracks that I can adjust the volume on. I'll put a link to that in the show notes as well.
That's a great way to bring your regular classroom online team. This is something that you would have done in a normal classroom, right? Mm-hmm. And so now you can put the audio track in, and that way the kids can do the same activity they would have done in the class, only they do it online.
Right.
Would you have them show their pictures? Like,
yeah, that was part of always the fun, right? Was to see everybody's different interpretations and, the different varieties of artistic skill. Mine was always a little rough. So, but kids always enjoyed it. And I think that, you know, as much as we can do to bring learning together, and, you know, kids want, when kids have an authentic audience, and when kids know that someone like that they care about is going to see it. I feel that really kind of ups the engagement level.
Love it. All right. So that was another teacher-generated one. The last one we're going to share is another teacher-generated one. And it is probably one that most of us are familiar with. Three-act math examples are perfect examples that show us how to use provocation videos to spark interest. You got Van Mayer does some great ones. Graham Fletcher does some. John Orr, Kyle Pierce. So just for a brief synopsis, those that don't know, the first part of a three-act math is usually a short little video or audio clip, could be a picture, and they show you something that sparks curiosity. They might ask a question, they might pose just a snippet of information or give you some kind of background knowledge, just enough to get the students thinking and wondering some things about what's happening in the video. So you would show the video first, and then you would take some time and ask the kids some questions. So we apologize, but this gentleman is actually clapping so fast that Zoom doesn't quite capture all of his claps. He's that quick. So we'll just show the video here. You can hear him, but you can't see him. He's that fast.
1, 2, 3.
So the premise of this is there's a current record that's 721 claps in a minute, and this gentleman was trying to beat the record. And so it shows you a time there, and you show the video, and then you might ask the kids, what are some questions you might have? Mm-hmm. And one that always comes up with my students anyways is they always ask, how would somebody even know to do this? Like, why does somebody spend their time trying to figure out the fact that this is actually something they can do? And of course, most of the questions they ask, they don't really know the answer to, but you're hoping one of them comes up with something like, so if he can do that many claps and that amount of time, then we should be able to figure out how many he can do in a minute, and then whether or not he can actually beat the record.
Right, because our real intentional goal here is to get students thinking about proportional reasoning and rate and unit rates and those kinds of ideas, and thinking multiplicatively so that they can determine this, but it's a much more engaging way to start that conversation than maybe with a pen and paper task.
I always give them a chance to see how they can do it. And it's surprising to see the coordination levels, how many kids, can get their hands going that fast. And then they start to realize it truly is a skill. All right. We have a screen animation one here that we're going to share.
Yeah, we'll just show a little bit of it, because the real intent is that we could use these kinds of technologies like animation software and screen recording software to create provocations, so in a different way.
Have you ever been cut off in a parking lot, signal light on, as you steer toward your coveted spot only to slam on your brakes at the last minute as someone pulls in front of you and steals your spot away? Imagine that experience and notice all of the data and observations landing on the first rung of your ladder. Now let's watch what we pay attention to on the second rung. Who cares that it's sunny out and the birds are chirping? The 50% off sign outside of your favorite store is meaningless. You filter in the sensation of your grip tightening on the wheel, you feel your blood pressure rise, you hear the squeal of your brakes, and you notice the expression on the face of the other driver as he pulls in front of you and quickly looks away. Time for our third rung. Ever since you were young, your parents taught.
So that would be, and that's kind of a way that we can also think about using videos, is that maybe it's just like where we stop a video and pause and get kids to think and have that discussion, as well as here's a way that we can integrate animation as well.
Okay, so this leads us to our participant works part of the session. We'd like to provide something that's tangible that you folks can take away and either use tomorrow or put away in your bank of teachable things that you pull out sometime later on. Last session, we did a collaborative slide deck where we posted some videos, some micro videos, and we asked you to generate some thoughts on how you could use these as prompts. This week, we have another slide deck that we're going to share with you cooperatively. We want you to help us generate some teachable concepts of how provocation videos can be used for each subject. So Teen's going to post the link in the chat, and it's going to take you to another slide deck. And we would like you to get to it here. We would like you to just simply instructions say, pick the slide that's they're organized by subject. Choose one and brainstorm an idea or two of how you think provocation videos could be used to spark a lesson. And then, like last time, we're just going to ask you to maybe, you know, mute your mic. And we're going to give you 8 minutes to just take a look at the slide, browse through, and if you can think of any ideas that you would like to add, just type away. And when we're done, we'll all come back and we'll share some of the great ideas that you folks have put on your slide deck. So just anytime you can unmute your mic or mute your mic, excuse me, and away you go. Okay, folks, we've reached the end of our 8-minute timer. Feel free to keep working on the document, though. I see a lot of interesting. When I saw the reading one, I think of the CNN 10 or the CBC Canadian version that we have in Canada. I can see a lot of those videos generating some curiosity for students in those videos.
I love how in 8 minutes, you know, putting together a group of great ideas and stuff that we could take right away and bring back to students. The one that resonated with me was in math there, and talking about like videos of prices in a grocery store to get ideas of a better deal. And like that idea that math, like it mathematizes the world, right? Everything, we really see it within context. Like I put a picture in there because I drive my wife a little bit nuts when we're out and I see things that are, I think we could use for math. So I saw this little piece of Parmesan cheese, and that little piece was $25. And I said, well, how much do you think that big piece would be? And then I love those ideas. I think that's great.
There are a lot of great ideas down here. One I've never heard of before. I can't remember what it is. On the media one, somebody put, and if I pronounce it wrong, I apologize, become a folly artist. Foley artist?
Yeah.
Change the sound effects in a cartoon clip?
Oh, yeah. They make the sound effects for cartoons and show and movies. So
Foley is a person then?
Yeah, it's a role. It'd be the person who, like, when you break a bone, they break a piece of, like, celery.
Oh,
I see. Clip-clop sounds.
Okay.
No, that's
I've never heard that. A lot of great videos on here, too.
Mm-hmm.
TikTok, kids are always talking about that one.
Yeah, that's a whole platform built on provocation, right? Is that TikTok is pretty much all provocation.
Mm-hmm.
I have a funny story. I follow somebody on Instagram and his name is Thielen Kiknaswe. He's from Bekajanong, but I believe he lives in Ottawa. And he's become famous for hoop dancing. And he speaks all over at different conferences for Indigenous youth. And so he created a video of his dad's braiding his hair and his mom is braiding his dad's hair. And he talks about why it's important for him to have long hair. And I contacted him and I said, this was really great. Is this something that we could share with students? And he said, yes, go ahead. And I said, he goes, but I don't know how I can share it with you so you can share it. I was like, can you just send me the original? And he's like, I made it on TikTok. It's like, oh my goodness, I feel so old right now because I was like, oh, I thought you like made it in iMovie or Clips or something and could share it that way, but you made it in TikTok. So there you go.
Made it in TikTok.
All right, we are coming up rapidly on 3 o'clock here and we wanna make sure that we respect people's time on a very lovely day.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I added Stephanie's, the link that she shared to the show notes with the group activity in Google Breakout.
Perfect.
So it's in the show notes.
Perfect. Thank you, Gretchen. And as usual, we are running short of our time for chat here. But again, if anybody has any questions or concerns, comments, you know, Gretchen, Tina, myself are available. Stephanie, she was a wealth of knowledge today. If you have any Google Meets questions, she's your girl.
Absolutely.
And,
just email me.
And we also, as always, we have a special talent that we need to share at the closing of our sessions today. So today's special talent is the very lovely, our very own Miss Gretchen on the accordion. Just a brief history, Gretchen. How long have you been studying the accordion, Gretchen?
I started taking lessons in October.
So, yeah. Whoa.
I've owned an accordion for about a year. So yeah.
Okay, so here we go. Here is Gretchen. Oh, it's going full screen, Gretchen.
Okay.
Oh no.
Okay, is it gonna go?
Okay. That is amazing because there's so much going on in there. It's like you're doing 14 things at once.
It's exhausting. It's hard to play. It's really heavy. It's super heavy. So yeah.
I can see your shoulders going up and down when
you're. I know. I'm gonna come back to work with grouping pipes.
Awesome. We'd like to just also mention this is the link to our show notes. If you go on there, they're organized by session date. So you'll see everything that we've done over the last 5 sessions, resources that people have shared, links to the chats are there, any resources that we've come across we want to share with you. And there is at the bottom a feedback. So anyone wants to give us any information, comments, questions, concerns, topics we can generate for the next session. We'd love to hear from you. I think that about wraps it up for today. We'd like to thank Stephanie McCollum from East Lambton for coming on and joining us today. And like Teen mentioned at the beginning, if anybody has anything that they want to share that they think is working great for their kids, they really like it and they're engaged, we'd be happy to have you come and share it with the rest of the folks on our office hours.
And thank you, everybody.
Yes, thank you.
That's it for today.